like home. And he said, and I said, you know, I said, I think that's probably true for a lot of people. And Travis just seemed to have an amazing way of being able to bring this family together. I know over the years that many of you in this room here tonight have not only prayed for Travis, but you have probably even maybe learned how to pray because of Travis. But Travis lived a life that we celebrate here tonight. And on behalf of the Lamell family, we want to thank you so much for coming and being here to celebrate his life. I want to share just a couple passages of scripture with you tonight to kind of get things going here. And a passage that I think is so fitting for Travis. In Psalm 116, it says, I love the Lord. He heard my voice and he heard my cry for mercy. And because he turned his ear to me, I will call on him as long as I live. The cords of death entangled me. The anguish of the grave came upon me. I was overcome by distress and sorrow. And then I called on the name of the Lord. Lord, save me. The Lord is gracious and righteous, and our God is full of compassion. The Lord protects the unwary. When I was brought low, he saved me. Return to your rest, my soul, for the Lord has been good to you. You, Lord, have delivered me from death, my eyes from tears, my feet from stumbling, that I may walk before the Lord in the land of the living. He goes on just a little bit further down, and he says, I will call up the cup of salvation in the name of the Lord, and I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. For precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. There's another passage of scripture that I think really fit Travis very well, and just by the way that he lived and the example that he set. The Apostle Paul writes in the book of Colossians, chapter 3, starting verse 12, he says, therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another. If any of you has a grievance against someone, forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body, you were called to peace. And be thankful, and let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Would you pray with me, please? Our Lord, we're here tonight wanting to celebrate the life of one so dear to us all. A son, brother, grandson, brother-in-law, cousin, friend, church family. We've come here tonight, Lord, to just take time to reflect on his life and to give thanks to you for allowing us to share it with him. Lord, we pray for your Spirit to give renewed strength, to just support and gird this family, Lord, with your tenderness and compassion, for you are the God of all comfort. We give you praise for this time here tonight. And Father, we just pray that not only will Travis be remembered, but that you would be celebrated in Jesus' name. Amen.
Sadness is found. I do believe.
this time we have some folks who are going to come up and share some personal thoughts about Travis. And one of them is going to be Tiffany Roberson. This is her cousin. And so Tiffany would like to ask you to come on up. And then David Tompkins and Elliot Blount will be the other two, if y'all will make your way up.
This is surreal to me, so I apologize if I don't look up. Our family, our side of the family is very small and we're very close. There's 9 and a half of us. Myself, my husband Tim, my mom Connie, my stepdad Bob, my aunt Teresa, my uncle Bill, my cousin Tyler, his wife Julie, and baby Alden, and Travis. We always spent every holiday together. The boys would go to the den and watch James Bond-a-thon, and the women would go to the kitchen and prepare the meal. Thanksgiving, my mom would host, and Christmas, my Aunt Teresa would host. We had the same meal for both. We would have turkey, and my stepdad and my Aunt Teresa would sneak off into the kitchen and argue over who would get the oyster of the turkey, and I only recently learned what the oyster of the turkey was. We would have homemade stuffing, and half of the family would argue that there was too much sage in the dressing. The other half would argue that there's not enough sage. We'd have Sister Schubert rolls, and instead of politely passing them to each other, we would chuck them at each other across the table. And we would end each meal with a no-bake pumpkin cheesecake. When I hit my early 20s, my mom decided that it was time that I stepped up and started helping with the meal, and she assigned me the no-bake pumpkin cheesecake. In the first year, I followed the recipe to a T. Had one cup of graham crackers, a stick of butter, mix those together, press them into a pie tin, and you mix a can of pumpkin, cream cheese, Jell-O pudding mix, and put that into the crust. The next year, I was a little more confident and still in my early 20s and thought I knew everything. And so I would just glance at the directions and took a stick of butter, a box of graham cracker crumbs, mixed them, pressed those into the pie tin, and a can of pumpkin, cream cheese, Jell-O pudding mix, pressed that into the crust that I had already assembled. And this year I realized that there wasn't as much room for my cheesecake portion, but I went with it, thought, you know, what could go wrong? And the next day was Thanksgiving, and our family got through the regular meal. We had the turkey and the stuffing and threw a couple rolls at each other, and it was time for dessert. We had our cheesecake, and as soon as we pulled it out of the fridge, my family knew that there was something wrong. And they understandably started to make fun of me, and it was well deserved. When we cut into it, we realized that I used a box of graham crackers rather than just a cup, as the recipe called. But I used the same quantity of butter that you needed for the right quantity of graham cracker crumbs, and so it was very dry and just very crumbly and inedible. But my sweet cousin Travis went up to the pie and cut a big piece and sat down at the table, took a big bite, and with his cheeks full of this dry mess, sat across the table, "I think it's great," and sprayed graham cracker crumbs all over the table. And I assure you it was not great, but my sweet cousin loved me so much that he didn't want me to feel discouraged, and he ate that whole piece of cheesecake to spare my feelings. This past May, my husband Tim and I had the opportunity to come to Clearwater for our wedding anniversary, and we got to have lunch with Travis. He met us out on the beach, and the three of us had lunch, and was in the middle of his finals. He should have been studying, I'm sure. Side note, I too tried to go to dental hygiene school, and I made it about 6 weeks, and I was not cut out for it. But he soared through that program, and he didn't need that extra study time, but I surely would have needed that extra study time. But in the middle of the meal, I needed to rip into a ketchup packet and grabbed it with my teeth and tore into it, and Trav was horrified. "Don't use your teeth as a tool," he said. And my husband, Tim, latched onto that saying, and he said it to me about every day since then. And I have not been thrilled with Trav for teaching my husband that saying, but it's a really sweet memory now. And I have a million stories that I could share of my sweet cousin, and all of them end with his heart just being really big, and his love for his family and his love for me just really surpassing anything that it ever should have been. So thank you.
Came prepared. Now I'm going to need this. When we got the news about Travis, I got a text message from Teresa asking me to say something because we were geek buddies. And that was definitely something me and Travis were, if not geek buddies. I remember early on in my time here at this church, Travis was when a group of guys and I made a comment about something not fitting well or staying still on my belt. 2 days later, out of the blue, I had a text message from him, not only with the description, but a link to where to buy it. That was just the way he was. And then somehow early on, and I want to say Teresa started this, but it got suggested that I go see Travis at dental hygiene school. I put it off, and then one day he called the office and just, I have no appointments. I can someone from the church come? And I was like, well, of course, Mike wasn't here. So I was like, yeah, I can do it. And just the cleaning? Yeah, I just need to clean. Travis lied sometimes. I went down there, and I remember the first appointment. He had to take x-rays of me, and there was this woman proctor in there with us, and she was 8 months pregnant, and Travis hit me in the side of the head with the gamma ray machine, and she just looked at me like, and then she started to explain to Travis the proper way, but Travis, it just ignored her and hit me upside the other side of the head. And then I decided, well, I'm going to play with this, and I was like, I wonder how much I can get from this visit. And she just went white and looked at him. And he, like, sat there for a moment, like, just ignoring her. And finally he looked over and was like, oh, he's a friend from church. It's okay. It's okay. And you could just see her go, oh. I was like, that was probably bad for the baby, but I want to be honest with you. Travis, my teeth were so bad, I probably shouldn't share this, but they met a certain criteria. He needed 2 patients with my level of teeth to graduate. So my one-day appointment turned into 4 or 5 over a year. So he put me in both semesters, but I think part of that was my fault because there would be times sitting in that chair, one of us would say something, and we would just die laughing. And one time I looked around, and we were laughing so hard, every other student in that class was looking at us. And the proctor came over and checked on us. I think they thought we had snuck a bottle of Nitrox because we were, and it was probably stupid. I mean, he had a sharp metal thing in my mouth. And we're just like, and I'm sitting there on the table with this knife in my mouth laughing like, it was the most enjoyable dentist year of my life. But after that, we started to play video games, and I learned the depth of Travis's knowledge. There were so many times we would just start sharing and stuff, life. Learned his knowledge of Star Wars surpassed me by yards and miles. I would sit there and be talking about, you know, there was this thing in this episode of the Clone Wars or the Mandalorian or one of the three good Star Wars, and he would like, oh, this minute into this movie or this episode, and I would just be like, nah, and he would be right. Always right. We would have long discussions about the different rifles that the stormtroopers use throughout the series. And for those of you not in the know, that's a serious geek discussion. I loved having a friend I could have those discussions with, but as we played, our friendship developed into more than just a casual relationship. It turned into, he became one of my gaming buddies, which is something very special to a gamer, to have a gaming buddy. Someone you can talk to on a game, and even when you're sucking, having a bad day, can't do anything right, he would be there to make fun of me. But I would share something in my life that, you know, struggle I was having, a problem I was going through, maybe something I was just frustrated with, and he would listen with a kind, sympathetic ear, and then he would give me a quote from Yoda that would get me out of it. Throughout my life, I've been an introvert. I am an introvert, and it's always been hard for me to develop close relationships. I develop friends as a minister. Now, that might not be one of the common traits of a minister, but I'm incredibly introverted and shy and don't let a lot of things out of the bag. There were many times when I was talking with Travis on a game that I would tell my kids to go in the other room because the discussion got that real. And it was too mature for them. Travis was one of those people I just connected with. There have been so many times over the last few weeks I've sat there and I started up my Xbox and got my phone out. And I would sit there and just miss not being able to text him and say, can you game tonight? It just meant that much to me. I will miss having my local gaming buddy. He was one of three that I felt a close attachment to playing video games. And I just am going to miss the times I could sit there and make a stupid statement about something I hated in a Star Wars movie, and he would quip back with me with a counter that would put me down. But I also want to share that I saw him serve so many people. I'm scared of heights, and we needed to fix these lights up here, and I was like, Travis, can you help me? Because I'm chicken. He did it. He got up in that lift that was precarious at best and went up there and brought down a 60-pound light all by himself while I sat down here shaking my boots. But he was always willing to help. I'd ask him to help with something, and he was there. I'd ask him to do something, he would do it. I need to bring this to an end, otherwise I'm going to go long. And I want to say to those of you who knew him his entire life and knew him much longer than I, thank you. Thank you for your influence and your support of him. And to his family and Bill and Teresa, thank you for raising Travis into the man that he became, my gaming buddy. He will always hold a special spot in my heart, as so many here is evident.
Several years ago, I approached Bill Lamell and asked him if he would mentor me. Abby was pregnant with Micah, who's our firstborn, and Bill was an elder here at the church at the time. Even though I didn't know him very well, I had gotten to know Tyler and Travis pretty well. I was just blown away by the young men that they are. And so I started paying attention to Bill and Teresa. And let me just tell you, these are the people we want to be when we grow up. The way they love Jesus, the way they love each other, the way they love their boys. the way they love other people, and the way that they raise their boys to love Jesus and other people and each other. It's second to none. If you need to know what a family who loves Jesus looks like, you don't have to look any further than right here. It's absolutely incredible. And Travis was one of my favorite people on the whole planet, but I have to be honest with you, I haven't called him Travis in over a decade, because when he was in college, he interned with me here at the church, and we were doing a sermon series at the time where we were giving away gift cards from local businesses every week. And given that he was the intern, it was his job to call all these places and see if he could get free stuff for them, for us to give away. You know, and so one time he called Rita's right down the road here, Rita's Italian Ice, and he said, "Hi, I'm Travis from First Christian Clearwater. Is there any chance?" And I said, "Sure, that'd be great." He said, "Okay, I'll be down in just a few minutes to pick up the gift card." So he goes down there, and he says, "Hi, my name's Travis. I'm from First Christian Church of Clearwater. I'm here to pick up the gift cards." And they looked at him funny, and he said, what's the matter?" He said, "Well, I don't have anything for Travis, but I got something for Chavez." And my man didn't miss a beat. He's like, that's me. It's fantastic. So Chavez was born. He's been Chavez to me ever since that day. He never complained about having to do that stuff. He was such a hard worker, but he was so much more than a hard worker. His sense of humor and his laugh were contagious, and I'm going to miss that laugh. I'm going to tell you that right now. I can't tell you how much fun we had making the Epic Man videos. For those of you that know, you know. Working with Travis, it never, ever felt like work. He was a genuine joy to be around. And also, let me tell you, you've never been safer than when you were hanging out with Chavez, because my man was packing at least 3 weapons at all times, okay? Maybe my favorite Chavez story started with a phone call from Inessie, actually, because she was watching Pastor Mike's dog. He's got this little dog, and she let the dog out in the backyard, and there was a possum back there. So she called me, and she's hysterical. She says, "If this possum eats this dog, Pastor Mike's going to hate me forever." And I said, "Well, I can't really come right now. I'm about an hour away. I'll get there as soon as I can." So I sprint over there, but Chavez beat me there. He's standing in the driveway dressed like Rambo. And I promise, my man had a headband on. He's got a bow and arrow and a knife the size of my forearm. Okay? And I said, "What are you doing?" He said, "I'm going to kill me a possum." Chavez was a servant for sure, but that possum never stood a chance. And if there was ever something going down, you wanted Chavez on your side. You know what I mean? The love that we have for the Lamels, there's not words for that. And the hurt that we feel right now is almost unbearable. It's moments like this where I just want to ask why. And God, I don't know how you're going to work all this for our good, but I know that you are, because that's who you are. But right now, I could use some of that peace that passes understanding. I miss my friend. And I can't wait to see him again, to talk about Star Wars, talk about how it took Epic Man 10 years to get 26 friends on Facebook. At the same time, I'm a little jealous, if I'm honest, because he made it. He's in the presence of Jesus right now. He's healed and he's whole. It's not going to be any more tears. It's not going to be any more pain. And I know heaven's a little bit more fun now because Epic Man has arrived. You couldn't spend any time with Travis without knowing that this man loved Jesus. And now he's made it home. Rest well, my friend. We'll see you soon. Love you.
do or do not. There is no try. That's what a little green guy by the name of Yoda once said. Basically, Yoda was telling young Luke Skywalker that he would never accomplish becoming a Jedi, trusting in his own ability and strength. Jesus in Revelation chapter 3 told the church in Laodicea that he wishes they were either hot or cold, but don't be lukewarm. Jesus knew that the type of life that the Laodiceans were living necessitated only their own power, their own strength. The result? Lukewarmness. Or a more modern word today, mediocrity. I say all that to simply say that mediocrity would never be the word that I would use to describe the life of Travis Lamell, a.k.a. Chavez, a.k.a. Epic Man. Words describe people. A life defines those words. Travis indeed was funny. No one enjoyed laughter more than Travis. He loved a funny story. He loved a funny event. He didn't even mind being the one that everyone else laughed at, as long as people were laughing. And with that being said, we did a sermon series several years ago called Living the Epic Life. And let's just say that a superhero was born. I think everyone here tonight needs to become acquainted with Epic Man.
Once in a generation, a hero was born. A hero whose strength, skill, and determination inspire the masses. This is not that hero. This is Epic Man. Epic Man had been reading 1 Peter chapter 2, where it says that we are to be a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, and that we should show the praises of Him who called us out of darkness and into marvelous light. Epic Man knows that to be truly epic, we must be willing to live out the scripture.
How could I be peculiar? How could I stand out? I love Jesus. Yes, I do. I love Jesus. How about you? Can you not hear me? Jesus is awesome. I know you can hear me. Hop in the car and let me tell you all about Jesus and how awesome He is.
While God calls us to be a peculiar people in this world and to proclaim His glory with our lives, Epic Man took a new approach and gave new meaning to the word peculiar. To be truly epic, our lives must differ from the lives of those around us. We are called to share the epic story of God with those in a dark world. However, we don't recommend doing it from the back of a moving vehicle with no driver. Tune in next week, same epic time, same epic place.
You can go on YouTube and you can find all four episodes of Epic Man. We had to cancel the series because obviously after watching this video, he requested a car. And we had to cancel that. But Travis was such a great sport, and he just loved to see people smile. Travis was loyal and compassionate. If Travis Lamell was your friend, he was a rock that you could count on to support you. Whether you're family, friends, those that just were acquainted with him, you knew what kind of a person immediately that he was. Travis, even though he experienced a lot of heart problems physically in his life. He had a bigger heart than most anyone I've ever known. And that huge heart was born out of a huge heart for Jesus. And because of his heart filled with love and for Jesus and people, Travis offered his life in devoted service to Christ. I have a picture here that was taken a few years ago with Travis as he was ordained here at our church to use his life and leverage it for the sake of ministry and sharing the good news of Jesus with people. He did that through youth ministry, but he did that also through serving in music ministry and safety team ministry or whatever other area that he could use to be able to make a difference. He was such a servant here in our family, and we are greatly going to miss him. He was always willing to serve. That was his nature. I'm going to kind of echo a little bit that what Elliot has said just a few moments ago. I've personally served in ministry for 32 years, but rarely have I ever seen the love, loyalty, and compassion revealed in a family like that of the Lamels. And Bill and Teresa, Tyler, Julie, Bill and Teresa, your son's legacy with his life goes back to what you instilled in him, the values that you both taught and modeled for he and Tyler. Travis was considerate. The Apostle Paul said in Philippians 2 that we should be humble and we consider others more important than ourselves. And I'm sure many of you could share stories one after the other. But I really appreciated one the other day that I read. Cody Morris posted it talking about Travis's willingness to help out and put stuff away after their wedding when they were trying to get away on their honeymoon. Travis's simple response was, "Get out of here. We've got this." And as Elliot told that story a few moments ago about Travis coming to my house late that night to save Sammy, that really wasn't an issue for me, Sam. But the family loves the dog. But I will say this. Now that I think about it, I don't think that there has been a possum sighting in our neighborhood since Travis was there. Travis was also brave. My really first, I guess we'd call major encounter with Travis's bravery came not long after our family moved here to Clearwater and Travis had to have surgery. Heart surgery over in Tampa, and I went over to the hospital that day. And I think, Tyler, if I remember correctly, you were at our house. But I remember praying with Travis and just seeing his confidence and his strength and just thinking of how brave he was at such a young age. And then just here recently, a couple of days before this last surgery, Jenny and I went over to the Lamel's house to have prayer with Travis as well as with Bill and Teresa. And even then, if he was afraid, we never saw it. Throughout his life, Travis has had to endure, go through, struggle with various types of health issues, and I'm quite confident that during a life of serving people, those times have brought intense periods of struggle as well. But through all of that adversity, Travis in his life never wavered. He saw life as an opportunity to make a difference. Whether it was through ministry, through being a dental hygienist, or whether it was playing bass in our praise team, or as a safety team member who was willing to stand in the gap and protect his church family. I know how brave and loving and compassionate was that Travis was, because as I stood here every Sunday morning, Travis sat right over there. He had my side every week as a member of our safety team. And I knew beyond a shadow of a doubt that whether it was anyone else in this group or whether it would be me, I knew Travis would be willing to take a bullet even for me, like I know he would for you. We live in a crazy world to even have to think about such things like that, but people like Travis were willing to stand in the gap. There's few like him. I think we could all learn great lessons from his bravery in his life. Travis fought well. The Apostle Paul would liken fighting to an athlete in training. But Travis lived life rather than enduring it. And he leveraged his life to make a difference rather than excuses. And he battled through his life with integrity and courage rather than fear and compromise. Because of that, his life made a difference, not only in mine, but obviously as I look out here tonight, you as well. I want to kind of just close with these thoughts. Last Thursday night, Jenny and I were honored to be able to be with Bill and Teresa when God called Travis to be back home with. And through the tears, through the heartache, Teresa said these words. He fought the good fight. He finished the race. And I would add that there is no doubt that he has kept the faith. I want to read that passage of Scripture because it's what's at the end of this passage of Scripture that gives us comfort. In those moments, as Elliot talked about the why, it says that I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I've kept the faith. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness with the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also all who have longed for his appearing. Bill, Teresa, Tyler, Julie, Grandma, the rest of the family, friends. Even though we know that Travis is now with the Lord, we cannot help but have hearts that hurt. There will be times in which tears will flow and his presence will certainly be missed and questions will continue to be asked. And many even ask of God. But I urge you, especially you, his family, to remember this, that God loves you with an everlasting love. Lean on him, for he, more than anyone, knows and understands your pain of losing a son. Allow yourselves, as I mentioned yesterday, allow yourselves to be rescued by his peace, to be replenished by his spirit, to be reinforced by his comfort, and to be reassured by his precious promises. Travis made a decision many years ago in his life to follow Jesus. And he did so at a CIY event. And after seeing the images of Jesus being tortured while this song played, it was later that night that he was baptized into Christ. And his life was forever changed and different. you've never accepted Jesus as Lord and Savior of your life, our gathering here tonight obviously is a sobering reminder that we will never know when our time is. But because of what Jesus has done for us, we can find hope and eternal life, just like Travis. to conclude tonight by sharing a couple of things with you. I just learned this today. A scholarship at Johnson University has been established in Travis Lamell's name for students who are going into ministry. Our church will have it posted on our Facebook page tomorrow, where you could help fund this scholarship. But we had a family in our church who generously got this scholarship started, and I'm just so excited that it's just another way in which legacy of Travis's love for people and serving the Lord can be remembered. And so we want to certainly encourage you to help do that. The goal on that, for that to really stay firmly established, is $10,000. So if you can help out, we'd greatly appreciate it. I want to close with this, and I debated on whether I wanted to share this, but because of the time of year that it is, I'm going to have to share this with you all. It's a poem that I found today. As I hear the many Christmas songs that people hold so dear, but the sounds of music can't compare with the Christmas choir up here. I have no words to tell you the joy their voices bring, for it is beyond description to hear the angels sing. I send you each a memory of my undying love. And after all, love is the gift more precious than gold. It was always most important in the stories that Jesus told. Please love and keep each other, as my Father said to do. For I can't count the blessing or the love that He has for you. So have a Merry Christmas. And wipe away the tear. And remember that I'm spending Christmas with Jesus this year. Would you pray with me? Lord, we thank you. We just praise you so much for how your Spirit works in and through the lives of people that just touch us beyond words or description. Such as with Travis. We were all going to terribly miss him. But Lord, oh, the precious memories he leaves. Allow them to linger, especially for this family, for everyone who's gathered here tonight. And Lord, we just celebrate you and thank you for life through Jesus. It's whose name I pray. Amen. I want to thank all of you so much for being here tonight and remembering Travis. God bless you all, and please have a merry day.